that brings us to what your current job.
Yeah.
And tell us about that.
Well, when I went up to headquarters in 1974, after spending 12 years here at Marshall Space Flight Center, we had to look what comes beyond Apollo. The big question was, now we have Apollo. It was finished in 1972 with Apollo 17. What next? And so they didn't have at that time any strategic planning, the capability of looking forward, of envisioning things 10 or so years in the future. And I could do it, so they brought me up to Washington and I took over a long-range planning office, had some good people, got some industry contracts and looked, you know, into what we call space industrialization, how to go back to the moon and on to Mars. And in the meantime, of course, the Apollo people were able to turn the remaining Apollo hardware into Skylab, the first American space station, which really was a modified rocket stage, the S4B stage, taking everything out and putting furniture inside, essentially, and putting it on a two-stage Saturn V and launching it, which was actually the 13th Saturn V that flew. And it turned into a beautiful space station which housed three crews at three people each. And then one day we gave it up, strangely enough, and it came back down. We wanted to extend its life, but to do that we needed a shuttle to push it higher up, and the shuttle wasn't ready yet. So it had to burn up. Next thing was ASTP, Apollo Soyuz Test Project, where for the first time we joined up with the Soviets. And the Soviets provided a Soyuz spacecraft, we provided the Apollo spacecraft, and flew, which launched on the last Saturn 1B. And there was a docking adapter, which we developed, which the Russian built, but we paid for. And so there was two spacecraft docked to each other in 1975 over the city of Metz in France. And the two teams floated into each other's spacecraft, shook hands, and it was the very first international flight, and the first international space station, you know, out of two spacecraft. It was very successful. Tom Stafford was our commander, and Alexei Leonov on the other side. We had three guys on board, they had two guys on board, so five people. And we engineers, naive as engineers are, thought, hey, now we got it made. From now on, we are working with them hand in hand and we can accelerate our progress. There was President Jimmy Carter, and he really didn't like all of this. He said, if these guys, the Soviets, can't agree or can't fulfill the Helsinki agreements of human rights and so on, we can't fly with them to space. So, the entire effort stopped, and it took another 20 years. It took another 20 years until we flew the first Russian on the shuttle. And so the politicians are usually engineers, you know, are naive about it, and we hadn't figured out on that. And Jimmy Carter didn't want us to continue. But then we flew the first Russian, and Krikalev, who's accumulated the most time in space, he's now director of the Russian Training Center at Star City. Very, very excellent training center. Our astronauts are training there, particularly in the future now, where they're going to fly on Russian spaceships only. He flew on the shuttle, and then we flew up to Mir, the space station Mir, Russian space station Mir, nine times, and seven astronauts stayed there for a long duration, learning how to run and build and operate a space station. We knew how to land on the moon. We knew how to build and fly a space shuttle, but we didn't know how to build and operate an existing space station, which is a totally different child, because with your orbital flights with a shuttle, which take only at the most 2 weeks, the current one is one of the longer, 16, and we are adding maybe even one day now to 17 days. And if you have a short duration flight, you can actually work in shifts. You have to work in shifts, don't waste any time. And one shift is sleeping, the other two are working, two shifts or three shifts. And there's a lot of noise on board, so it's not really a very nice home during that time. It's high energy work. On a space station, it's just like home. You have day, you have night, and night is quiet. Everyone sleeps in their little cabins. They get up in the morning, they have breakfast, they check out all, then they have a daily plan, which we beam up to them. They have a lunch period. In the evening, they report down what they have done, and then they go to sleep. It's just like on at home, but that takes a different way of running things, automatic things. Do you want to keep certain alarms on during the night, or do you want to turn them off? Are they important, and all of that? And we had to learn that. And so we had these American astronauts up there, and even a woman, Shannon Lucid, who broke the record as far as women in space is concerned at that time. And she was so popular with Russia when I'm in Moscow and talk with my friends over there about, for them, Shannon Lucid was the best. The training specialist in Moscow, an elderly lady now, she's feared and was feared by all cosmonauts for being a tigress. I mean, she really whipped these boys into using the treadmill, into using this, into doing that in order to keep them healthy. She developed the machinery, and she said Shannon really was the only one, you know, who didn't break for lunch if it was exercise time. She did all the exercise just like I had told her to do, but all the boys, you know, they were slackers, you know, they tried to get away with little exercise. So I admire these people for this this passionate approach to spaceflight, which they have, which we don't, or it's gone. It's gone, really. Today, people are wondering, can you make a money? Can you commercialize space? How can you turn it into a private enterprise, like running an airline? People have forgotten, if they ever had it, the romanticism of spaceflight, the passion, the widening of horizon, the curiosity, the excitement of exploring a new frontier and then stepping over it and building a new frontier and again stepping over it. That's what's driving people really. And all the talk, we have nothing against trying to commercialize launches, particularly unmanned cargo, that's been done all the time. Deltas and Atlases fly all the time. But people, and particularly with the idea that, hey, you can get it cheap. Manned spaceflight cannot be reduced in cost. If you do that, von Braun always said, you have to cut corners in order to have the bottom line, the profit for the commercial flight. You need someone to pay so that you can make a profit, and that is usually the taxpayer. So even if a private company launches people, the cost of man-rating, everything is so high that the commercial company wouldn't turn out any profit. That means it wouldn't work, so they need the government. So taxpayer would have to continue to pay, which is just what they're doing today already with the shuttle. But not too much will change with people. With cargo flights, I would say, yeah. And so von Braun always said, and that was the first law of spaceflight, he said, if you get into manned spaceflight, you have to accept the fact that it's expensive. If you don't have the money, then the kitchen is too hot for you and you better stay out of it. Don't get even, but they'll have to find out the hard way if they don't believe it. Anyway, so the ISS came about with the Russians. Originally, it was Space Station Freedom under Clinton, and then we said, hey, it's good to have Europe on board and Canada on board, and then the Russian Mir space station came to an end slowly. It was old, inside living was becoming dangerous, the thermal control systems started leaking, and you got this glycol or this antifreeze stuff which you put in the car, floating in the air, the ice were burning, and there were microbes, microorganisms on board which had mutated, and they were eating the metal. So they were really the cause of those leaks. And that's one of the dangers you have. You have little microbes that eat metal and eat their way into the stuff. So at the end, one of the boss of the Russian space station, Valery Rumin, he said, I don't believe it, but I'll check it out myself. And now he's a big bear, a big Russian bear, huge, and he wanted to fly on the shuttle, so he had to lose some weight. And for example, we had to build special gloves for his hands, which were, you know, like a steak. And he flew up to Mir on one of the shuttle flights. His wife is a cosmonaut too, Elena Kondakova. She stayed on Mir long before him. And he was a little mad that she had flown more in space than he was. So that was one of the reasons he wanted to fly up there in the first place, because of the competition with Elena, his wife. And he found out that, yes, Mir is at an end. It's unsafe. And then the Soviets or the Russians, grudgingly said, okay, we bring it down. And we want to join the ISS. And that's when it was called the International Space Station. We tried to seek for other names, all kinds of names. And all the nations provided their suggestions. And none of them was really a good suggestion. So we stayed with International Space Station. And the Russians immediately said, hey guys, we have all these nice pieces still standing around from the older days, the service module, which we wanted to turn into a second Mir. But it's still standing there with a dust cover over it. And we got some other pieces. Do you think you can use them in the ISS? Well, we jumped for that. We said, we want that, and we're going to buy it from you. The FGB is a part which we bought from them, 600 million. And the service module, the Russians contributed, it was their share, which is now the main module in the ISS. And it was supposed to be the second Mir. The life support system on board the ISS is Russian built. Well, yeah, we didn't have that. We had a shuttle and lunar landings, but we couldn't build a space station life support system. So we are depending today on a Russian life support system and trying valiantly to come up with an American life support system at the same time. It has some development problems right now, but it's already working, producing oxygen from water and urine. But the Russians are way ahead, and we have to rely on that. The power system on board the space station is American-provided, much of it at least. And communication also is American, because the Russians only have ground stations, maybe 7 or 8 of them, and then the station is out of sight, and they can pick up communication only 90 minutes later. While we have the S-band TDRS, tracking and data relay satellites in geosynchronous orbit, we have 24-hour coverage communication-wise. So that's where we are in the driver's seat. They are in the driver's seat when it comes to life support, which is a beautiful partnership. And so I'm so delighted. I mean, I grew up in the space business. It's now 50 years. I'm so delighted that all that Cold War stuff is long behind us. When I came to Moscow the first time in 97 or so, I couldn't believe it. I thought this is incredible. If anyone in science fiction would have written that these huge countries, former enemies, were working together, learning each other languages and trying to adjust their engineering standards, I would have said it's fantasy, absolute fantasy. And today it's a total reality, and it works so beautifully. The cultures had to be understanding, of course. We had to understand their culture better and not to touch sensitive points, and the other way around. You know, they laughed. They did, you know, they stayed in Texas a lot, living there actually, with their families, a lot of Russians, and they laughed their head off about Texans and the way of life. they couldn't see, you know, what's so great about Texas. But today they enjoy it, and vice versa. You know, our guys are thinking Moscow is great and Star City is great. So that has happened, this growing together of cultures and tremendous respect for each other. That is, and I'm working right in the middle of that to answer your question in a roundabout way. I'm working on a daily basis with the International Space Station. I'm responsible for the daily operations on board. And the Russian segment, because I understand Russia and know what the Russians are doing. And on the headquarters level, of course, I'm not dealing with the technical stuff. That's mostly at JSC, Johnson Space Center. But on the headquarters level, to have that overview, what's happening. And I'm one of the very few engineering types up at headquarters. The rest are administrative, MBAs and whatever. And every time there is a technical problem on board, they come to me and want to know what's happening. So I have to write a daily report, which goes out to you know, at least 300 people in the White House, in Congress, high-level type people who want to know exactly what's happening. And also, I put it on the internet so the whole public can read it, all the reporters. Otherwise, they would scream Freedom of Information Act and all of that. So everyone can look into what's happening on board the space station. It's totally transparent. And I don't mince words. If there are words there, if there's, you know, something bad happening, I mention it in careful language, but there is no cover-ups. There will not be any cover-ups since a long time. We've learned the hard way. Early on, NASA said, hey, let's not tell that too much before we know exactly what's happening, otherwise people get unnecessarily scared. I remember the very first time when we had a pending collision with a piece of space debris heading our way. And I put it in my daily notes. I had to take it out again. You know, somebody screamed, hey, you can't do that. The whole nation will go crazy. I said, no, but I mean, the taxpayer pays for it anyway. Why don't we put it in? And we get around that. So every time we have something like that, a conjunction, we call it, two pieces coming close to each other, the space station maneuvers out of the way. And you know who is doing the maneuvering? Russian. Moscow is calculating the changes, and Russian thrusters on board, we don't have American thrusters, push the space station out of the way. But the information, what piece is coming, where and when and how big it is, comes from our radar system, from the Air Force mostly. So again, we have this partnership. The Air Force tells NASA there will be a piece coming 3 days from now. Then we ask our people in Moscow to do the calculations, then they come back, beam up the parameters, mostly automatic, and then the sequences, the automatic sequencer on board the space station ignites the engines at the right time, and it moves a little bit aside, and then the piece goes by maybe 5 miles away instead of 1 mile away. Now, those are examples where we are working hand in hand. And there is no way you can do it in the future without that type of work. So at the times when nations go it alone, like right now the Chinese are doing it, are long gone. I guess when a country like China right now wants to develop its own capability, that's necessary, because once they join the partnership, they want to be considered equal partners, you know, not small brothers, not little brothers. So they do have to develop the competence themselves. But sooner or later, you know, they'll be approaching us, hey guys, why don't we do it jointly? It's too expensive for one country in the long run. We are in a great business, we really are. And I sure wish that the general public would get a little bit more information on that, that the young people would look into it and see, you know, that future, it'll never come, get down again. It'll go up again, on and on, because that's the way we are built. People like me and others, we are so stubborn, hangers on us, that, you know, it's amazing, right? Grown people, grown men, like Werner von Braun and Tsiolkovsky, Konstantin Tsiolkovsky, and Hermann Oberth, and Robert Goddard. I mean, these are all smart people. They have been smart people. Why did they do this if it's crazy? You know, they must have been pretty sane. And so if somebody who hasn't looked into it, or some politician says, oh, that's all child stuff, you know, they're just living a childhood dream and so on, there's much more behind. We are programmed inside. Humans are programmed. We don't quite fully understand why we are doing it, where this curiosity comes in. The little baby starts crawling in your living room on the carpet to explore the corners. You know, it just goes around. That's what we are doing in space right now. We are crawling out, trying to explore the corners, just because the corners are there. And because knowing then we were in that corner has widened our horizon. And once you widen the horizon, you have widened your consciousness. You know, you think, oh, those old days, I was so narrow, you know, now I know, I understand the world. When I talk to, you know, the real traditional Texan guys who thought that Texas was the world, you know, and nothing was any way close to Texas or bigger than Texas, and now they are flying between Moscow and Texas all the time, they have a totally changed world view. they really have, particularly those Texans who are living in Moscow right now with their families and are kind of sad when they have to go home. And I've talked to them.